Hi, this is Pastor BJ from Joshua Springs Calvary Chapel in beautiful Yucca Valley, California. We want to thank you for joining us here on JSTV as we've been going through the book of Acts with Senior Pastor Jerel Hagerman. So without further ado, go ahead and open up your Bibles, maybe grab a cup of coffee, and join us for the service already underway.
That's awesome. Well, let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the truth of the Holy Scriptures. And Lord, as we open our Bibles today, we want our hearts to be open to receive your truth in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you'd like to turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 10, we're coming back to Acts. Actually, 10 years has passed in the book of Acts since Pentecost. And what we found in Jesus' great commission, he told the disciples, I want you to go into all nations and make disciples of all people, teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you and baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And lo, I'm going to be with you to the end of the age. And my friends, that began on Pentecost, and as they shared there, the door was open for the Jews. In Acts chapter 8, the door was open to the Samaritans. And if you remember when Jesus promised the Holy Spirit, he said, you're going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, where they were, Judea, the area surrounding it, Samaria, a little bit farther away. But he said, you're going to be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. But my friends, they'd never walked through that. And so 10 years have passed. Now, my friends, without Acts chapter 10, you and I wouldn't be here today, because now the door is going to be opened to the Gentiles. In verse number 1 of Acts chapter 10, there was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of what was called the Italian regiment. So no doubt he had seen Rome. No doubt he'd seen lots of conflict. He's like a master sergeant. He's over 100 troops. He's a backbone of the Roman military. But I want to tell you about the Bible and centurions. In every single case in the Bible, the centurions are always held in the highest regard. You know, we have a little bit of a picture here because we're by the 29 Palms Marine Corps base. And through the 26 years that I've been pastor here, I've met some of the most stellar men and women who have served our country. And if you're here today and you're currently serving, we want you to stand up. We want to thank you right now. Thank you very much. Now, they're living in Caesarea. Now, you have to understand, if you got sent to Israel, it was like getting sent to 29 Palms. It's the outermost outpost there, you know. And so nobody wanted to go there. There was always trouble there. So they made their headquarters in a place called Caesarea. Caesarea is right on the Mediterranean Sea. Absolutely gorgeous, water crystal clear, aqua blue, you can swim all year long. It's absolutely beautiful. And still today, when you go, you see the ruins of what Rome built there. They had a harbor, and in this harbor, out way out there where the entrance of the harbor was, they had these great statues, and they built them so they looked like they were walking on the water. It was amazing. They had a hippodrome where they would do chariot races. They still, today, you can see the ruins of Herod's palace. You can see his swimming pool jutting out over the ocean there. Amazing ruins in this whole area. Plus, the amphitheater that they've rebuilt there in Caesarea, where Paul made his great defense before Agrippa. So, a fantastic place. And it's always the first place where we go in Israel when we arrive, because we go to Tel Aviv, which is ancient Joppa, and we go to Caesarea. Caesarea, 65 miles northwest of Jerusalem. So here we have this man, a Roman soldier, a centurion, a devout man in verse number 2, one who had feared God with all his household, who gave alms generously to the people and prayed to God always. Now, my friends, in the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus said this, ask And in the Greek, it's keep asking. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be open. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be open. Here was a man who is not saved. He wants to find the truth, and he's seeking the Lord. And here's the promise of Jesus: if you seek, you shall find. And this man, we're going to find out, even though he was a good man, even though he did good things, he wasn't saved. And my friends, you may be sitting here today just doing good things. We're going to see at the end of the day is not going to be good enough, because we are all sinners. We all fall short of the glory of God. In the book of Romans in chapter 3, it says, "For there is no difference, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus." Just to make sure that you all know that you're not good, the Bible says in the book of Hebrews that he knows the thoughts and the intents of our hearts. Now, only you have to live in your own dirty little mind, right? Some of you are thinking a dirty thought right now. How dare you? You're in church. You got your Bible open. So here's the thing. We all need saved. We all need a Savior. It has nothing to do with the outward. It has everything to do with the inward. At about the ninth hour of the day, that's 3 o'clock in the afternoon, he saw clearly in a vision an angel of God coming and saying to him, "Cornelius." And when he observed him, he was afraid and said, "What is it, Lord?" You got to love this guy. He's an officer. He answers in military fashion. An angel of the Lord appears to him, and his response is, "I'm going to be obedient. What is it, Lord?" And he said to him, "Your prayers and your alms have come up as a memorial before God." Now, my friends, I want to point something out on this. The Bible makes it very clear that there is an eternal reward for whatever we do. The Bible says that if I give a cup of cold water in the name of Jesus, there's going to be a reward for it. You sign up to help teach Bible college, a Bible school, there's going to be a reward for it. You give to help the children in Malawi, there's going to be a reward for it. Absolutely everything we do, there is a reward. And basically, there's only three areas that God has given us: our time, our talents, and our treasures. Now, my friends, again, for everything that we do, do you realize there were volunteers when we made the announcement about redoing the stage that showed up and whipped this out? Is that awesome? And I want to tell you, they have a reward in heaven for giving of their time and their talents. The Bible tells us that whatever we give, when Paul is writing the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 8 and 9, the Macedonians, and encourage them to be givers. Then in the book of Philippians, when he's thanking them, because the Philippians are the Macedonians, this is what he says: not for the gift, that's not it. "I'm thankful for what is put on your account." Now, I want you to notice something here. Three times, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, this man's gifts are recorded by the Holy Spirit for all of eternity in the Word of Scripture. And I want to tell you something. For everything that you do for the Lord, whether it's your time, your talents, or your treasures, there is an eternal reward for that. Now, the Scripture goes on. In verse number 5, "Now send to Joppa and send for Simon, whose surname is Peter. He is lodging with Simon the tanner, whose house by the sea. He will tell you what you must do." Now, I got to be honest with you. If there is anything in my life that I could have, it'd be a house by the sea. You know, that's something that's always been on my bucket list. Preferably one of those places in Carmel. I have to tell you, whenever I do that drive through Carmel, by the time I'm done, I have to repent from the sin of envy and greed. And I don't even want the big mansions. That cute little cottage right there, that's good enough. The one that's right there on the water, yeah, that's the one that I want. You know, it's so funny. I never saw an ocean until I was 21. And I absolutely love the ocean. But I did watch TV. And this is one thing Hollywood lies to people all the time. I'd watch these shows from Los Angeles, Huntington Beach, Newport Beach, Laguna, and I'd see these people carefree running into the ocean. And then I came. It's like, whoa, this place is cold. Why didn't anybody tell me the water was cold here? Year-round, it's freezing cold, you know? Now, the Mediterranean, not that way. You can swim year-round, very nice, very warmer than the Pacific here in California ever gets. So he's staying with Simon the Tanner. Now, Simon the Tanner, you're a tanner because you're cleaning skins. So Peter would have been perpetually unclean because if you touched an unclean animal or a dead animal, you were unclean. So no doubt this guy was a Christian. He had opened up his beach home to him. I love when we go to Israel, sometimes very early in the morning, you can go through Old Joppa, which is very similar built to what it would have been like even in Bible times, these tiny little places with the rooftops. And they still have a place called the House of Simon the Tanner there right by the beach. And it says, and when the angel who spoke to him had departed, Cornelius called two of his household servants, a devout soldier from among those who waited on him continually, and he explained all these things and he sent them to Joppa. Again, true military fashion, right? He received his orders from the Lord. He's going to carry him out. This is the part of the story I just love. Because God is speaking to both hearts at exactly the same time. Two people who do not know each other, who have never met each other. God is going to do a miracle. He's already spoken to Cornelius's heart, who lives in Caesarea, 30 miles to the north of Joppa. But now he's going to speak to Peter's heart. The next day, as they went on their journey, they drew near the city. Peter went up on the housetop to pray about the sixth hour. Now, my friends, don't you love to be at the beach? Now, here's one of the things. We're going to see Peter's hungry. Here, actually, this is one of my favorite things to do. If I'm sitting on the beach, I am totally happy, and I can sit there all day, and I can eat all day. But here's how you do it. You want to learn how to eat all day? Start with something salty, go to something sweet, back to salty, back to sweet, back to salty, back to sweet. You can eat all day long. Of course, you're going to not feel so great when you get home, but, you know, for the moment, it's good. So he's hungry, and it says he became very hungry and wanted to eat. But while they made ready, he fell into a trance, and he saw heaven open and an object like a great sheet descending to him and let down to the earth. In it were all kinds of four-footed animals of the earth, wild beasts, creeping things, that's bugs, and birds of the air. And a voice came to him saying, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." Now, I got to tell you a funny story. You know, we're talking about having this gun safety course here. Tooele has one of those, Tooele Springs. Now, when they announced that, they had 150 people show up. They have 120 people in their church, but 150 showed up for this. And it's funny because they actually have a hunting ministry there. It's called Acts 10:13, rise, kill, and eat. So, you know, anybody want to start a new ministry here, rise, kill, and eat, you know. The Lord is speaking to Peter. These things are all unclean. And Peter, now sounding like a Pharisee, he says, "Not so, Lord, for I have never eaten anything common or unclean. I've only eaten kosher food." Now, my friends, I have to tell you something. You can't say this sentence. You cannot say, "Not so, Lord." Now, you can say, "Not so, buddy." You can say, "Not so, wife." I don't recommend that. But you cannot say, "Not so, Lord." If he's Lord, can you be telling him no? And so he's answering here. And it says in verse 15, and a voice spoke to him again the second time, what God has cleansed, you must not call common. And this was done three times, and the object was taken up into heaven again. Now, Peter's a slow learner. Three different times, this comes down, it goes back up. Now, while Peter wondered within himself what this vision which he had seen meant, behold, the men who had been sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate. They called and asked whether Simon, whose surname was Peter, was lodging there. And while Peter thought about the vision, the Spirit said to him, behold, three men are seeking you. Arise and go down and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. My friends, it's a picture here of God working in two hearts, independent of each other, and yet simultaneously, he's going to accomplish something. Now, the scripture goes on. In verse number 20, arise, therefore, and go down with them, doubting nothing, for I've sent them. And then Peter went down with the men who had been sent with him, and he said, yes, I am he you seek. For what reason have you come? And they said, Cornelius the centurion is a just man, one who fears God and has a good reputation among the nation of the Jews, and was divinely instructed by his holy angel to summon you to his house and hear the words from you. Now Peter's going to do something that maybe he's never done before. He's going to invite a Gentile in his house, and eventually he's going to go to a Gentile's house. My friends, I want to tell you something. All racial divides that man put up are sin. Because God so loves the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And I want to tell you, it makes no difference the color of one's skin or the culture that one comes from, because how many races are there? There is one race. It is the human race. We all come from Adam and Eve. We also all come from Noah and his wife as well. And so God is going to tear down these man-made divisions that there are. In verse 24, the following day they entered Caesarea. Now Cornelius was waiting for them and had called together his relatives and close friends. And as Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshiped him. But Peter lifted him up, saying, stand up, I myself am also a man. I want to tell you something. A pastor should never be a celebrity. And unfortunately, there are pastors who permeate that, wanting a celebrity status among the people. And my friends, you can turn on television, you can see it all the time, you can run into people, and you can find it. When I was in the Holy Land last year, this guy gave me his business card. And seriously, I didn't even want to hold on to the business card, because this is what it said: the most holy reverend so-and-so. Well, first of all, there is only one most holy, and anybody living here on earth, all right? It's the Lord Jesus Christ. There's only one reverend, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. And my friends, and Peter wanted nothing to do with it. A number of years ago, I was invited by this pastor to come and speak at his church. And when I pulled up to his church, the premier parking spot said reserved for the pastor. And I want to tell you, you can search this campus, you'll never find a parking spot reserved for the pastor. In fact, the pastor walks to church. And if the pastor does drive, I would never take a front parking spot, because I want to give those for the people that are coming. But here's the deal. Reserved for the pastor. I actually got there before he did. When he arrived, two people from his church went out to carry his stuff in. After the church service, we had a fellowship time. But the pastor and I were ushered into a separate room. There was a couple ladies serving us on gold china, gold rim china with gold silverware. And I'm sitting in there, I'm hating every second of it. And I said, you know what? I'd really rather go out and talk to the people. You know, this is just, you know. And so fortunately, I just got up and went out and talked to the people. You know, when you go to the Vatican, and again, if you want to go with us, in about 16 months, we're going to plan a trip there to Italy, an extended time only in Israel, or only in Italy. We're not going anywhere else. But when you go to the Vatican, Michelangelo made a great statue of Peter. Now, you'll know it when you get there, because there's this huge line out the door, everybody waiting in line, so that when they get to the statue of Peter, they kneel down and kiss his feet. Now, through the millennium, so many people have kissed his feet, he doesn't have toes anymore. Ptomaine poisoning, I think, is what it was. Actually, it reminds me of a story. You know, in Kansas, during harvest time, there's combines. And combines have 1,000 moving parts, and every year somebody loses a limb, loses something. So I'm driving a wheat truck that's loaded full of wheat, so I'm only going 30 or 40 miles an hour. I'm out in the middle of nowhere, and an ambulance zooms past. And I notice that on, you know, how ambulances have a thick back bumper, there's a box on the back bumper. Well, he's going down the road. I see that box fall off. So when I get up to it, I stop the wheat truck. I get out, open it up. It's packed with ice. And I move the ice, and inside is a big toe. You know what I did? I called a big toe truck. Now, how many people have heard that story before? How many new victims do I have? Now, you have to understand, I love my jokes. I love my jokes more than anybody loves my jokes, and I laugh at my jokes. And here's the thing, I can tell the same joke 100 times and laugh every time, so I'm glad you did too. I love it. And I'm all happy with myself. You gotta understand that. Really happy with myself. After the 9 o'clock service, I asked Marilee, I said, did you like my big toe truck story? And she said, I've heard that story many times. That's what happens when you have to sit through multiple services. All right, let's go on. Now that I'm all happy with myself. In verse 27, stand up, I myself am also a man. And as he talked with him, he went in and found many who had come together. And then he said to him, you know how unlawful it is for a Jewish man to keep company with or to go to another nation. But God has showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Now you got to laugh at verse number 29. Therefore I came without objection as soon as I was sent for. I asked then, for what reason have you sent me? How about telling the gospel? That'd be a good idea, wouldn't it? Isn't that what the Lord said? Go into all the world and preach the gospel. I'm here. What do you want from me? You know, why are you here? Why am I here? And Cornelius said, 4 days ago, I was fasting until this hour. And at the 9th hour, I prayed in my house, and behold, a man stood before me in bright clothing and said, Cornelius, your prayer is heard. And look, it says it again. Your alms are remembered in the sight of God. Therefore, send therefore to Joppa and call Simon, whose surname is Peter. He is lodging in the house of Simon the tanner by the sea. And when he comes to you, he will speak to you. So I sent to you immediately, and now you have done well to come. Therefore, we are all present before God to hear the things commanded you by God. We're all ears. I want to hear. You know, I'll never forget. It was a number of years ago. We had church, and it was Wednesday night. And this 18-year-old girl, 17-year-old girl came in, and we were done. You know, people that were there praying. And she came forward, and she said, I want to ask Jesus into my heart, which is great. I prayed with her. Well, later on, I Jackie Roberts was our youth pastor at that time, and I saw Jackie afterwards, and he said, it was the worst sermon that I had ever given in my life. He said, it was so terrible, I just closed. I didn't even do an invitation. I said, yeah, I know, a girl from youth group came down to big church to get saved, you know? It is telling the absolute truth of the gospel. That's what God has called us to do. In every opportunity, every single one of us have been called to witness. In verse 34, then Peter opened his mouth and he said, in truth, I perceive that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, whoever fears him and works righteousness is accepted by him. In the book of Ephesians, in chapter 11, it says, therefore, remember that you were once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision made by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now Christ Jesus, you who were once afar off, have been made near by the blood of Christ. And my friends, that's where we are today. We have been made near by the blood of Christ. And it goes on to say in verse 36, the word which God sent to the children of Israel, preaching peace through Jesus Christ, he is the Lord of all. That word you know, which was proclaimed throughout all of Judea, and began from Galilee after the baptism which John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all things which he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, who they killed by hanging on a tree. And God raised him up on the third day and showed him openly, not to all people, but to witnesses chosen before by God, even to us. And Peter writes in his epistle, we were eyewitnesses, even to us who ate and drank with him after he arose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people and testify that is he who was ordained by God to be the judge of the living and the dead. My friends, I want to tell you, every sermon in the book of Acts has three components. Every single one, we see it here. Verse 38, Jesus lived. Verse 39, Jesus died. Verse 40, Jesus rose from the grave. So every single sermon that there is in the book of Acts, Jesus lived, he died, he rose from the grave. Here a number of years ago, I was talking with a pastor and it was getting close to Easter and he said, what are you going to preach for Easter? I sort of was stunned by the question. I looked at him and I said, I'm going to preach a resurrection. I'm going to preach a gospel message. Well, I know, but people have heard that. It is the power of God. That's what changes people's lives, is that Jesus, the Son of God, truly lived, died on the cross to pay the price for our sin, and rose again. And then Peter says this, we will all stand before the judge of the living and the dead. Now, my friends, this is where it's different. If you are a believer, let me tell you how that judgment is going to go. We are told in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 6, therefore we are always confident, knowing that while we're at home in the body, we're absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith and not by sight. We are confident, yes, well pleased, rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Therefore, we make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well pleasing to him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. Knowing, therefore, the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but are well known to God, and I trust are well known to your conscience. This is called the Bema Seat Judgment. Now, my friends, first of all, this isn't a heaven or hell judgment. When we become a believer, we're acknowledging that we're sinners, right? We're acknowledging, I'm guilty, I'm in need of a Savior. So at that moment, I am forgiven. But from that moment then, I make it my aim to be well-pleasing to him. Because there are things that my life has. I have time. Every one of us have been given the same amount of time. 24 hours a day. We even have a term, spending time. So we spend that time every day. So part of that time ought to be spent for the Lord, right? Because that's eternal. God's given me talents. He's given every one of us talents. And for every one of us, whatever talent that God has given us, we can use that talent for the Lord. As I mentioned, this was done, volunteers, by people in the church that have talents. And it was done beautifully. And then there's treasures. So all of us have the opportunity. And here's the thing. Everything that we invest in any of these categories of our life is for all of eternity. So our judgment isn't a heaven or hell judgment. Now, if you're here today and you're not a believer, all right? Now, I want to make crystal clear that you understand something. I don't care whether you're married to a believer. I don't care whether you have Christian kids or Christian parents. I don't care whether you're in a Christian school. You are either born again or you're not. You're either saved or you're against Christ. You're either for him or against him. You're a saint or you're an ain't. There is no counting for being close. You can be all surrounded by Christians all your life long and yet not be a believer and not be a Christian. So this is what I want to make sure on. But if you're here today, and you know whether you're born again or not, if you are not born again and you haven't wanted to listen to anything else, I suggest you listen to this part because you're going to be here. All unbelievers will appear before the great white throne. Not the believers. We face a bema seat. That's a different deal. We've already declared ourselves sinners and saved by the grace of Jesus Christ. But for unbelievers, pay very attention because you will live this. Revelation chapter 20, verse number 11, I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven had fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead and those who were in it. Death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them, and they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Anyone not found in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So this is what happens. All unbelievers, when they die, they go to hell. Hell is in the center of the earth. That is not the final judgment. There is a physical death and hell, but there is a second death that is mentioned here. And so here's what happens at the great white throne judgment at the end of the age after Jesus Christ has returned. Everyone who is not a believer, great and small, will stand before the Lord. In that, the books are going to be opened and people are going to be judged by what is in the books. What's in the books? Well, first of all, my friends, the Lord knows every thought that you've ever thought. Anybody want to get saved now? Because you will be accountable for it. Jesus said this, you will have to give an account for every word that you've ever uttered. Anybody here want to be accountable for every word that they've ever uttered? How about this one? I'll be go to hell. I'll be damned. Next time someone says that in your presence, you can say, yes, you will. Because it's by every word that you speak. But then here it also says it's by every action. Again, the books are open. My friends, there isn't a person in this sanctuary that doesn't have things that they've done in their life that if they were up there on the big screen, they would be mortified, every single person in this entire sanctuary. But I want you to understand, unbelievers, that is your future. And here's why. There isn't one person on that day that's going to be able to say, I'm innocent. Not one. Because God has laid eternity in everyone's heart. The heavens declare the glory of the Lord. There's a book called Eternity in Their Hearts where people have gone to unreached people groups who have never heard the name of Jesus. And you know what they find? They find people that Jesus has been ministering to in their hearts, even though they knew absolutely nothing. Do you realize every single person that has ever been born has something that God has put in them? It's called a conscience. Have you ever seen that tiny little child want to do something wrong and that look in their eye? They know what they're doing and they know it's wrong, right? If you don't believe it, have a child. That'll teach you. But here's the reality of it. Now, my friends, the very next verse says this. In Acts chapter 10:43, to him all the prophets witness that through his name, whoever believes on him will receive the remission of sins. Whoever believes in him will receive the remission of sins. Whoever believes in him will receive the remission of sins. I went to visit a 90-year-old woman this week, a real sweetheart. I go in and I sit down with her and we visit for a little bit, and then I share with her Romans chapter 10, verse number 9, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved, and everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. And I took her by the hand and I said, do you believe? And she said, yes, I believe. And my friends, here's the thing. When we become a believer, our sins and our lawless deeds, he will remember. Our sins and our lawless deeds, he will remember no more. Though our sins are as crimson, they will be white as snow. As far as the east is from the west, that's how far he removes our transgressions from us, and we won't face that great white throne judgment. We'll see Jesus when we die. Now, before I finish my message, I want to give you an opportunity to pray and receive Jesus and believe right now. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, I do believe that you are the Messiah who lived, who died on the cross to pay the price for my sins, and who rose again. And so I ask you into my heart to be my Lord and Savior. I want to receive the forgiveness of my sins in Jesus' name. Amen. Now the scripture goes on. I love this part. While Peter was still speaking, he doesn't even get to finish his message. They've all become believers. While he was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word. And those of the circumcision who believed were astonished as many came with Peter. Peter brought six witnesses with him. We're going to see that in the next chapter. He's going to get in trouble for this. So he brought six witnesses with him. And believed and were astonished, and as many as came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also, for they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Now, my friends, exactly what happened on Pentecost has happened again. The Bible tells us, and again, the very words of Jesus, because he knew this was going to be an issue. In Luke chapter 11, in verse number 9, Jesus says, I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. If a son asks for bread from any father among you, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will he give him a serpent instead of a fish? Or if he asks for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If you, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? So what we see here, they're saved, and they're baptized in the Holy Spirit. They're speaking in tongues, just like they did in the book of Acts. In 1 Corinthians is written to a messed up church. The whole thing is problems that there are in the church. And one of the problems was there was all kinds of spiritual kookiness that was going on. So in chapter 12, Paul writes, I don't want you to be ignorant about spiritual gifts. And he goes on in that chapter, to also say at the end of it, these rhetorical questions. First of all, are all apostles? The answer is no, everybody's not an apostle. Is everybody a prophet? No, everybody's not a prophet. And he goes on, do all speak in tongues? Well, obviously, the whole list of answers is no, so that one's no too. But then he says this, but eagerly desire the spiritual gifts. Now, when I was first saved, I was in an ultra-Pentecostal charismatic church. Now, we all came out of dead denominations, but there were practices that we did that were very Pentecostal, but not scripturally based. And thus, the church never grew because you couldn't bring anyone new. You never knew what was going to happen. And even when it did happen, you couldn't explain what had just happened. It was rather scary and frightening to people who didn't have any idea what was going on. And so maybe some of you today have had experiences like that. And so when we start talking about the Holy Spirit, and especially the gift of speaking in tongues, you're hyperventilating a little bit. Your arms are immediately crossing. And it's like, yeah, no. This is why Jesus says, if you ask for a loaf of bread, is your father going to give you a stone? If you ask for an egg, is he going to offer you a scorpion instead? If you ask for a fish, is he going to give you a serpent? Is that our Father, which art in heaven? No. And so that's why Paul addresses this. So he says, eagerly desire spiritual gifts at the end of chapter 12. Then chapter 13 says, if I speak in tongues all day, if I speak in tongues and have the men of angels and yet have not love, I'm only a clanging cymbal. It's not just about sign gifts. It's about the balance of the fruit and the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Then he comes back in chapter 14. Predominantly, the whole chapter deals with tongues. There's a few other things. But Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 says, for he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men but to God. Every single time you see tongues interpreted in the Bible, including in Acts chapter 10, it is always magnifying God. There is never one time in the Bible that you will find there is a message from God to people in tongues. Not one. And it goes on to say, he who speaks in a tongue edifies himself. It's the only gift that edifies ourselves. And my friends, there have been many times in my life where the problems were so deep, I didn't have the answers for them. I wasn't even sure what the problems were. And as I began to pray in the Spirit, bypassing my intellect, God did a mighty work in my heart and life. And then Paul says this, I wish that you all spoke in tongues. So it's something that every single one of us should desire. And then he goes on, yet in the church, I'd rather speak 5 words in a known language than 10,000 words in a tongue. If I was just standing up here speaking in tongues, would that do you any good? And that's why you're not going to hear it on a Sunday morning. Are there other times where you are? Yeah, there are. Retreats, afterglows, those types of times when it's just believers, yeah, there's a different place because it is a gift that we should desire. But the gift is the Holy Spirit. He gives us then the different manifestations. Sometimes we need the gift of healing. Well, you need that if you're praying for the sick, right? Sometimes it's a gift of faith. Sometimes it's a word of knowledge. Sometimes it's discernment. There are other gifts like administration, hospitality, and even giving is a gift of the Holy Spirit. So my friends, again, before we close, I want to invite you to do exactly what Jesus says. Ask, seek, pray to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. So would you pray with me right now? Lord Jesus, as I've asked you into my heart to be my Lord and Savior, now, Lord, baptize me with your Holy Spirit. Give me the gifts and the fruit of the Spirit and use them in my life as you desire. And the last thing that happens here in the book of Acts in this chapter, can anyone forbid water that they should not be baptized who have just received the Holy Spirit just as we have? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord, and they asked him to stay there 10 days. Well, I have great news for you. If you're a believer but have never been baptized, today's the day. And you know what's wonderful? Almost every time we have people full clothes. They didn't bring anything to get baptized in. You can get baptized in your clothes. It's a nice day. You'll get home, I promise, you know. But here's the thing. What happens is an obedience in our heart to the word of the Lord, Jesus himself. His command is for us to get baptized. It's not for salvation. It is for declaration. And when we go under the water, we are identifying with the death of Jesus because his death is what paid the price for our sins. And we are saying this, I'm going to die to my old way of life. As we're brought up out of the water, the same Spirit that raised Christ Jesus from the dead gives to us new life. And we are now born again believers who are making a public declaration to the Lord Jesus Christ. I am not ashamed to be your follower and to be known by your name as a Christian. We make a declaration to Satan, I am no longer going to serve you. We make a declaration to our friends and family, I am a believer. Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. Hallelujah. Let's stand. So if you want to get baptized, follow me out. We're going to go right now. And let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this day. And we pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would work in our hearts and lives. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen.
Thanks again for tuning in. We hope you enjoyed the message. If you'd like to contact us, you can contact us at www.joshuasprings.org or you can give us a call, 760-365-0769. Hope to see you next week and God bless you.
Judge is my defense, I'm going free. On the gavel fell, I heard the freedom bell ring through the heart of hell. I'm going free, I'm going free. Glory, glory, hallelujah, you threw my shackles in the sea. Glory, Jesus is my lady.
Hi friends, again, this is Pastor Jerel from Joshua Springs Calvary Chapel in Yucca Valley, California. I want to share something with you that's very dear to my heart. In Matthew chapter 19, in verse number 13, it says, "Then the little children were brought to him, to Jesus, that he might put his hands on them and pray. But the disciples rebuked them. But Jesus said, 'Let the little children come to me, and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of heaven.'" We've had a Christian school here at Joshua Springs for over 20 years, and I've always loved the fact that we're able to raise up the next generation. Here about a year ago, though, the Lord began laying something on my heart that I've thought about for many years but had never implemented, and we were in the place where we were able to do it. We call it our Matthew 19:14 plan, which is basically this: let the children come. And so as a part of that, we here at Joshua Springs, if you want to enroll your kids in school, you can pay general tuition and there's no other requirements. But if you can't afford Christian education, but you're a wonderful Christian family and you want your kids to have that, the Lord has opened for us a way, the Matthew 19:14, and here's how it works. If you attend Joshua Springs 40 times during the year, if you volunteer during the year, 40 hours of service, and that's, you can be an usher, you can help in a classroom, you can teach Sunday school, that if you donate 40 hours of time and you tithe 10%, your kids are able to come to school here with no additional cost outside of book fees. And so as you look at that, I want you to think about it, because even if you live in the Coachella Valley, we have lots of people up here that commute down below to be able to go to work. But I want you to think about it, because you could buy a much nicer house here for a lot less money and have your kids in private education. And so it's something to consider. You know, one of the things that we have to remember, it's a biblical mandate that we raise up our own children in the ways of the Lord. And of all the things that we do as Christian families, there's nothing more important than raising up the next generation, and that begins with our own household. So if you're interested in the Matthew 19:14 program for Joshua Springs Christian School, simply give us a call. Our phone number is 760-365-0769, and we'll be happy to answer your questions. God bless you.
Heart and my soul, I give you control. consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and grace become my embrace, to love you from the inside out. Everlasting, your light will shine when no one else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all faith. And the cry of my heart is to give you praise from the inside out. Lord, my soul cries out. Everlasting, your light will shine when no one else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all faith. And the cry, I rest on